Zoom these days has a whole bunch of extra steps that I'm still trying to figure out. But it doesn't change the fact that today's lessons are a doozy. Both the Genesis and the Mark readings have been used to define who's in, who's out, whose relationship or lack thereof is socially acceptable. Which is why in many churches today, the sermon will be about the letter to the Hebrews. But what's more important than the sermon that I give, though, is the one that you give yourself. A woman once said that hearing this gospel read in church felt like having someone dump garbage all over her. It didn't matter if she'd cleaned up and put on her Sunday best that morning, because after hearing these words, she felt like she couldn't get rid of the stink of her divorce. So since some of you may be aware of a lingering whiff, we're going to dive right into the hard stuff. Because the reality is, nearly all of us have been impacted by divorce. Our own, our parents, our friends, our relatives. Divorce is a reality, a messy one, a grief in our lives that does not often come with casseroles, sympathy cards, or a funeral. Episcopal priest Barbara Brown Taylor describes her own divorce this way. A non-functioning marriage is a slow asphyxiation. It is waking up despised each morning, listening to the pulse of your own loneliness before the TV begins to blare its raucous gospel that you're nothing if you're not loved. Disassembling a marriage in these circumstances is as much fun as amputating your own gangrenous leg. You can do it if you can to save a life or two or more. Save a life or two or more. One of the few things I know for sure about God is that God is in the business of saving lives. Let me be clear, a marriage is intended to be lifelong, but sometimes it's not. We are imperfect after all, and we love imperfectly. I have sat with some of you at the end of a marriage, bearing witness to the pain, offering space to confess your wrongdoing, assuring you that not even divorce can separate you from the love of God, and blessing the new way that is before you. Let me also be clear, this is not primarily a sermon about marriage. The modern church has far too long ostracized single people, elevating the nuclear family as the best or holiest way of practicing faithfulness. But that is not true and is absurdly out of step, both theologically and practically. More Americans are single now than ever before. 49.5% of us, in fact, are either never married, divorced, or widowed. I do not believe that God thinks that nearly half of our family situations are insufficient or incomplete. So this is not a sermon about marriage. This is a sermon about the strange good news that God calls us into a variety of imperfect relationships designed to create belonging, companionship, and healing. This is a sermon about the strange good news that God created us as imperfect beings who love imperfectly. This is a sermon about what a faithful, God-bearing relationship looks like in all of our human relationships, not just a marriage. Because the reality is, Jesus is not all that invested in the nuclear family. He often said strange things about it, like you should leave your family behind. And even from the cross, he was creating new lines of kinship among unrelated people. He seemed way less interested in the particularities of what happens inside your bedroom and way more invested in how you internalize the life-giving message of the gospel, how you live it out in the streets, in the workplace, and yes, in your home. Jesus quotes Deuteronomy and Genesis here in his conversation with the legal experts and points us back to God's design for creation. At the beginning of creation, he says, God made them male and female. Some people say that the important thing about this first human relationship is difference, that the essential element of the story is the anatomical difference between Adam and Eve, But that misses the point, at least the point of this second creation story. There are two creation stories with different emphasis. But in this one, Adam, the human, the earthling, does not recognize his companion for her difference, but for her sameness. The first human says, "At last, this one is the same as me. Bone from my bones and flesh from my flesh." There's belonging here. Feminist theologian Elizabeth Fiorenza says, "The Genesis passage is best translated as the two persons, man and woman, enter into a common human life and social relationship because they are created as equals." The first act of human community, then, is the recognition of our underlying sameness, our belonging, our ability to companion one another. And that is not at all limited to marriage. All of us are situated in relationships where we work out in fear and trembling, where we practice what it means to love God and to love our neighbor. Because this project of being human, well, it's a group project. The reading from Genesis teaches us that from the very beginning, we're created for interdependence. We are designed to human life raft our way through life. The Episcopal Church has spent the better part of 25 years knee-deep in the study and reflection on households of all kinds in light of the possibility of same-sex marriage. The report that put forth our inclusive marriage liturgies has a few beautiful passages about what is distinctive about Christian relationships. Here's one of my favorite sections that's amended slightly. "We believe that human relationship is intended by God for our mutual joy, for the encouragement and support given one another in daily life and changing circumstances, for bringing God's grace to our community, and for deepening of faith as we experience God's love in our love for one another." I love this description because what would happen in our neighborhoods, in our workplaces, in our schools, if this is how we covenanted with one another? The passage goes on, "Relationships should be nurtured and characterized by fidelity, mutual affection and respect, careful, honest communication, and the holy love which shall enable us to see in each other the image of God." Holy love, which shall enable us to see in each other the image of God. That is the gospel truth at the heart of today's readings, the challenge to see one another as bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh, not just your beloved one, but your embattled one. Before I close, let me be clear. If you are married, it is meet and right to nurture that covenanted relationship. A friend who's a couples therapist says most couples show up in her office about a year after it would have been helpful for them to start counseling. "My marriage is way more important to me and to my quality of life than my car, and yet I take my car in for routine maintenance every 3,000 miles. Attending to your marriage, if you have one, is a good idea. Let me also be clear, relationships are constantly changing. We are constantly changing. That's what it means to be alive. Sometimes our relationships can change alongside us, and sometimes they cannot. A relationship that cannot change, that cannot grow, that is slowly killing you like a gangrenous limb is a challenging place to be. If you are in that place, I do not know exactly what the path ahead of you is, but I promise I will walk it with you. Finally, let me be clear. A marriage is not the only or even necessarily the best place to practice this kind of love. What would it look like if all of us undertook a daily practice of seeing everyone we meet as bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh? Of shaping our daily interactions around fidelity and steadfastness, mutual affection and respect, careful, honest communication, and the holy love which enables us to see in each other the image of God. I believe, my friends, that we will move just a little bit closer to the reign of God, a little bit closer to an imperfect constellation of relationships, offering belonging, companionship, and healing. In God's name, amen.